So here we go. So the name of the book and the name of our gathering every Wednesday night between now and the beginning of Advent is the Wisdom Pattern, because I'm going to use the skeleton of Richard Rohr's latest book, which is a reworking of some of his audio tapes, but he's reworked it since the pandemic and since our other crises. So that is why we are using that. And then let's go to the next slide. I wanted to remind you all, and also to say to people who have just joined us for the first time, that our work together for the last year and a half has identified several, I think there were 8 themes that we identified. And rather than teach them, I'm simply going to allude to them. I remember somebody saying, I really appreciate this slide, when we put it up for the first time. I've expanded it since then. But there have really been themes of people that we've consulted, from Richard Rohr, Cynthia Bourgeau, Otis Moss III, Catherine Meeks, and several others. The first theme, get the story right. And tonight is going to be focusing on story anyway, and we'll talk about that some more, narrating and re-narrating. The next is Otis Moss's point early on that what distinguished slavery in the U.S. from slavery in any other country, and I'm reaching for a book, is that it was set up on racial caste. And I'm holding up a brand new, thrillingly wonderful book by Isabel Wilkerson, who wrote The Warmth of Other Suns. And the name of this is Caste. And she really writes gorgeously. This is called the nonfiction book so far of the 21st century. And she talks about how caste underlies the problems of race. Then another theme has to do with how racism in America has been fed by a distorted, hyper-individualized religion. And we'll get into that later on, not tonight, but some other on subsequent meetings. But I'm alluding to Robert Jones's new book, Quite Too Long. I interviewed him for 2 weeks in the forum this summer. I really commend that conversation to you. 4 is that racism is in the culture, or it is systemic, requiring a cultural transformation. And I was just arrested on a walk when I was listening to a presentation by Robin DiAngelo on white fragility, and I'm holding up her best-selling book, really worth reading. Anyway, she said that racism is not a moment. It's a system, and we swim in it. And so many people get really distracted by calling people racists or saying, I'm not a racist. That's not the point. The point is to be aware of the system of racism in which we live. The next theme is Einstein's really important notion that you can't solve a problem with the same level of consciousness or the same consciousness that caused it. That you have to have a new mindset or a transformed, healed consciousness in order to change something or solve a problem. The sixth one comes from a New Yorker interview with Brian Stevenson. And before I forget, I watch YouTube as a way of going to sleep every night. And the algorithm pulled up for me, because of my interests on YouTube, a conversation between Brian Stevenson and Isabel Wilkerson just 2 weeks ago. Brian Stevenson is absolutely a kid excited about Isabel Wilkerson's work. Nevertheless, in this New Yorker interview, he said that protests are really wonderful, and the work that is going to change things is even deeper than protests. And after that, I interviewed Dr. Beverly Tatum, former president of Spelman, and I asked her, what is the deeper work? And she started on the minimum wage. She said, it's got to be economic work. The seventh theme, and we'll get to a particular slide just about this in just a minute. We really gravitated, kind of the soul of this gathering, gravitated to the idea from an Oprah Winfrey graduation address about what is your work today to bend the universe a little more towards justice? What's your essential work? And finally, the eighth theme, you can't change the culture by yourself. A healthy community is absolutely required. So a new narrative or story and new consciousness calls forth for learning projects. Number one, learning the story of racial hierarchy in America, learning the religion of Jesus as distinct from the religion about Jesus, decentering whiteness, a courageous narrative-based conversations. And I hope that if you've not seen my courageous conversation with Brian Benedict of our parish, who served in Vietnam, and I was a conscious objector during Vietnam, and he took me out to lunch. He says, I've never even looked at a conscious objector. I don't even know what one is. Will you tell me how you became a conscious? And it's just a wonderful time that he and I had. And it was all based in our stories. And that's the only way we're going to get out of this polarization trap in this country. And finally is the old Einsteinian principle that you have to have a new level of consciousness. So when I took a summer break at the end of June, Panky Miller said, you know, Ed, there's several of us who would like to have some time just metabolizing all of that stuff that you have presented to us. And can you bless that? And I said, oh gosh, yes. Well, y'all, about 30 of you all met all the way through July and August. And this was the schematic that you used which I plagiarized from the National Episcopal Church, that moving forward, we have to do what we need to do about learning, as well as praying, as well as acting. And over the course of the summer, that group of 30 plus people actually were in three different groups, a learning group, a praying group, and an acting group. And we are continuing all of this. Now, what we're doing tonight is a continuation of the learn, although please understand that you, if you ever want to lead a small group, or if you ever want to make a presentation at St. Luke's, you simply all just step forward, raise your hand, and the only thing we will oversee is to make sure that every small group is a safe small group. Then there are a million different ways to pray, and we've got a group of people who have said, now let's get serious about all the different forms of praying. So Martha Eskew is going to be teaching on our Going Deep series. We've got some other people rigged up. Some people have asked me to do a few little podcasts about how I pray. So the praying function is going strong. And then finally, the ACT group has been led by Adelaide Steedley, and they've got some very interesting passions about kind of two areas, if I understand it correctly. And Adelaide, you can correct me in the chat. One has to do with any kind of atonement we need to be actively offering in corporate prayer about systemic racism. And the other has to do with repair work that we have to do in terms of justice and repairing the breach. So that's going to go forward also. Here's the slide about Oprah Winfrey. This is the exact slide that I had on May 20. And it's very interesting. I kind of divide the summer into two halves, pre-George Floyd and after George Floyd. And this was pre. And we were already talking about systemic racism because Ahmaud Arbery in Brunswick had been killed. And Oprah said, it's really important to ask during this crisis, what is your essential service going to be? What really matters to you? The fact that you're alive means you've been given a reprieve to think deeply about that question. So how will You use what matters in service to yourself, to your community, and to the world. Create more equity, justice, and joy in the world. And that's from her speech called Graduating by Evolving. And Panky told me that this became kind of one of the focal points of the July and August discernment project while people were discerning what their essential service is. We'll come back to that in a few minutes. So here's the beginning of the new slides. So tonight's focus is story. And the thesis is the shape of your life is determined by the story or stories you live by. So the idea is to become aware of the story you're living by and change it if you're called to. Now, this handsome man here is professor and vice chancellor of Sewanee, Reuben Brigady. He sent out a letter yesterday from the Board of Regents of Sewanee. And it is a declaration that they're going to change the story at Sewanee. It was just one of those cosmic clicks that this came into my inbox yesterday. But I thought that it would be important to underscore how so many people and institutions are taking a look at the stories they live by, the stories they are ready to leave behind, and the stories they're ready to embrace. To use his words, this is a pivotal moment in the life of the University of the South. With its historic statement, the Board of Regents, and you all can Google this and download it, it's really great. The Board of Regents has firmly rejected our institution's past veneration of the Confederacy and the Lost Cause movement. Never before has Sewanee leadership so clearly and powerfully separated itself from those beliefs. And I'm just asking you to read that as from that story, the honoring the Confederacy story and the Lost Cause story. So by facing up to our past, we embrace the promise once and for all of moving beyond it. In recognizing without equivocation what Sewanee once advocated, the university liberates itself to embrace a new role for which its story has in fact granted it special provenance. Now he's talking about a deeper story, a truer story, to lead in embracing equality and inclusion, because the stark lesson of our own history shows us that only in recognizing our common humanity can we become what we are fully capable of being. Now that last sentence, for those of you who are Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. nerds like I am, will realize that that is a phrase from his last Sunday sermon preached at the National Cathedral, when he said, "You can never become what you were made to be until I do that. And I can never become who I was created and made to be unless you are." And then he says, that is how the cosmos is constructed, or the universe is constructed, is that interdependence. We'll come back to that story in a few minutes. Next slide. That is the definition of Ubuntu. Thanks. Thank you very much, Adelaide. That's exactly. Now, I put this slide together and had never used it before, but I have been deeply concerned about Senator Tom Cotton and some other people citing as necessary evil of slavery as he is escalating his attack on the 1619 Project. And if you haven't read the 1619 Project from the New York Times Sunday Magazine, please do so. In any case, that whole critique of American history as being rooted in the slave industry is now being attacked. And the issue is, who is going to control the story? And that's a theme in the musical Hamilton, Who Lives, Who Dies, and who tells your story. Now, before we get into, we're getting close to getting into the book, but before we get there, this summer, actually it was the first weekend in September, Ilia Delio wrote this, which is exactly two different stories about God. Whether God is outside of us, up there and out there, or whether God is outside and within us, as Ephesians and John 1 say. She says, we are prodigal children of an infinite love. The mounting crises of our time, COVID-19, global inequality, rampant injustice, and an accelerating climate emergency, show that we are exhausting our capacity to center our lives in the radiating power of God. Or that's a story. The energy that is ours to co-create our world is being squandered on superficiality and indifference, turned against our living planet and each other. And I would add to the list of things that we are squandering our lives on is polarization, division, and ad hominem attacks. She says, we're called to be more. We have the capacity for a new world, and the energy for this world is already within us. It is the presence of God Omega. So I hope you're getting the theme. One more slide before we get into Roar. Many of you like Charles Eisenstein, and we've taught Charles Eisenstein here on Wednesday nights before. And this summer, in August, a new organization of podcasts and videos called Commune put together 8 of his video presentations. And if you paid a little money to get beyond the paywall, you could have the actual texts of those presentations. Suffice it to say, we will get into it later on, but tonight, suffice it to say, is he says there are two stories, the story of separation and the story of interbeing. And we are in the between time, where the story of separation is transitioning to a story of interbeing. If the story of separation is the foundation of your life or your culture, anything you do to contribute to a new story is part of political change because, and I love this statement, the story creates the system and we create the story. Now let me stop there and say, I have mentioned before, having gone to South Africa and gone to a particular church here in Birmingham, where in those two buildings, white men got together and created theological rationales for apartheid in South Africa and Jim Crow segregation in Alabama. Robbie Jones, in his book, Quite Too Long, points out the painful and sad and angering reality that these two systems would not have had the energy had it not been for Christianity. White supremacist culture Christianity that said that white skinned people have more intrinsic value than people with dark skin. So Eisenstein goes on to say, we are serving the birth and growth of a new story. It's not a story that he's making up. It's not a story any human being has made up. Even though it is a human story, the story has life. It's coming to us. It's emerging within us and it's going to carry us. As long as we can serve it faithfully, it will carry us into a different world. Now, my friends, I rush to say that that story he's talking about, which has life and is coming to us, and it is going to carry us, and it is emerging with us, is the story referred to in the first chapter of John's Gospel. The Word, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and nothing was made without the Word. Nothing was made, in other words, without the story that Charles Eisenstein calls the story of interbeing, of oneness, of intertwinedness, of interdependence. So that brings us now to my choosing this book for our study until Advent. As I said earlier, it's Richard's latest book. It's actually, some people on his staff said, we need to take a set of slides, a set of cassettes that you made earlier that have never been put into a book and revise them in light of the age of COVID-19. That's what he's done. And it makes intuitive sense to me that the wisdom pattern or the wisdom story, just to stay with the metaphor for the night story, really is a repetition of order, disorder, and reorder. We'll come back to that in just a second. But he's simply saying that since 9/11, it's gotten worse in terms of patriotism becoming divisive rather than inclusive. The surge in church attendance is a distant memory. All of this is a long-standing, deep need for social reconstruction. And more than anything else, he thinks we're facing a crisis of meaning. So I want you to think about the crisis of meaning being a story issue. So now, the first point that Richard Rohr makes in this book, the first chapter, is that St. Francis of Assisi, had a threefold pattern or story for living in a scary and disenchanted universe. And they have to do with prayer, nature, and suffering. And what he's saying is that prayer needs to be, well, at least for Francis was, experiential. It was an experience-oriented going to the depths, as opposed to the old religious repetition of old formulas. It led him to discover and journey to an alignment with his true self. Second, it had to do with a certain view of nature. Francis sought direction in the mirror of creation. We are situated in a meaning-filled cosmos, a sacramental universe, where every, to quote Elizabeth Barrett Browning later in this chapter one, where every common bush is a fire with God. I love that way of thinking about the burning bush, holy ground Moses experience, that is available to everybody who has a perception that everything in nature is alive with God. And the third part of the pattern of Francis of Assisi, or the story, has to do with suffering. Francis looked to the community of people who suffered for an understanding of how God transforms us. And we have a couple of slides about transformation in just a second. So he was always ready to read reality from the side of powerlessness. Well, that's straight from Matthew 25. Where Jesus says that if you really want to know me, if you want to see me, feel me, minister to me, then look at the lives of the least of these. People who are sick, people who are naked, homeless, hungry, strangers, alone. So Francis was simply kind of offering up a part of the pattern of Jesus there. Now, I want to go back to the prayer paragraph and explain the asterisk that I inserted here in the slide. Richard Rohr is, when using the word discover, as understanding that prayer is a time to discover one's true self. That is directly from the most important chapter of anything that I ever read from Thomas Merton in his book, New Seeds of Contemplation, Pray for Your Own Discovery, where he says that Salvation is not about heaven or hell. Salvation is about discovering your true self and being liberated from living out of your false self. So he says, pray for your own discovery. Now, Richard Rohr spends a good deal of time distinguishing between the modern civilization and the postmodern civilization. He says the prevailing story of the modern era or modern civilization versus the most cyclic or paschal worldviews or stories. Now I'm going to have a series of slides here that contrast different kinds of stories. And what he's going to be setting us up for throughout the book is the modern era or civilization had faith in progress. Things will just get better and better as long as we are educated, reasonable, and scientific. And the world will become a better place. Analysis of parts is really important. And that's more important than a synthesis of the whole. However, he's setting us up, obviously, for him to critique this way of living. That kind of faith in progress, no matter what, and really focusing on the parts rather than the whole, that doesn't serve the soul, the heart, the psyche, the inner world of meaning, or the community, the human community, and the planetary community. Well, the big wake-up moment for Europe to say, no more of this modern civilization faith in progress alone, was the Holocaust and World War II. He says it caused the modern civilization paradigm to collapse into postmodernism. This collapse didn't happen in the US during World War II. That didn't collapse until the late 1960s, after the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. and Robert Kennedy. For him, postmodernism is a critique of modernism's false optimism and trust in progress. There must be something more than the physical, because mere science has left us powerful and ineffective, but also ravaged. No, I'm sorry, powerful and effective, but also ravaged in the most important areas of our humanity. So he's setting up a contrast between the philosophy of progress as distinct from cyclic or paschal worldviews. Now, for those of you who know about the word paschal, it comes from the words to suffer, and it has to do with the paschal mystery or the mystery of faith, which is Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Rohr is saying that's more descriptive of the way life works than this march toward progress. How many of us who were children of the 60s and 70s thought that we had put to bed all sorts of things about the equality of women, of people who are LGBTQ, of people of color, only to discover, particularly in recent days, that that is just not holding forth. A lot of stuff is dying, and we need to give our energies to resurrecting this story of interbeing. Yeah, progress leaves so many behind. Thanks, Mary Lynn. Progress in air quotes. I hope you see that. Thank you very much. So, the modern story trusted in logic and reason, with science seen as able to create a totally predictable universe. The postmodern story deconstructs everything, leaving only the ego that polarized and divided without a sense of the whole. Now, before we move to the next sentence, please understand in those first two sentences, you've got the foretaste of the subtitle of the Rohr book. The book is Wisdom Pattern, And then under it says order, disorder, and reorder. So he's setting you and me up to understand that the modern civilization we thought was the ordered way to be. And then with the Holocaust, World War II, and the assassinations and the setbacks in civil rights movement in the US, we had a time of post-modern consciousness or story. And he is going to obviously set us up for seeing that the way to kind of hitch your wagon to something that will not disappoint you is a certain kind of arrangement with suffering and death and resurrection. He quotes Stephen Carter, which is a wonderful African-American critic, social critic, that postmodern deconstruction, the disorder part, leaves us with a nothingness orientation or nihilism and a materialistic worldview with no religious views. Religious, I'm just reminding everybody, religious means to re-ligament or rejoin. And that's what is the essence of healthy religion. And it leaves us with only belief in power, possessions, and prestige. I mean, there are people walking around with us who believe that the only thing worth pursuing, power, possessions, and prestige. In fact, many critiques of white evangelicalism is that their soul has been sold to get power and possessions and prestige. And Rohr says toward the end of the chapter, loneliness is a sad product, byproduct of most postmodernism. And Judy Andrews says, and cynicism about logic and science, exactly, in this postmodern world. So he says, you have two stories. The exchange value perspective on life versus the inherent value reading of life. And it's all about who can win, who has the biggest toys, who has the most power, prestige, and toys. It is the market mentality, the uncriticized or unredeemed market mentality, I'll add. In a market-driven culture, things no longer have inherent value, but only an exchange value. Everything is transactional. Will it sell? Will it win? Will it defeat the opponent? And this win-lose story, Rohr says, is an actual lose-lose story. It's not a win-win story. It's a win-lose story. And you categorize certain people by being losers. The commodification of creation is making the temple of creation into a place of mere buying and selling. To hell with the notion of going out in nature and simply having a conversation and interaction with nature, understanding that at the core of absolutely every created thing is the same power and love that's at the core of us. So the exchange value perspective on life versus the inherent value reading of life is to be, what's at stake there is that life is about the great mystery, mystic union, transformation, not merely social order and control. So you have the win-lose story. And another way of talking about the win-win story is to call it the transformation story. We think we can dominate the shadow self rather than forgive it, transform it, and embrace it into a larger wholeness. That's what Jungian psychology calls us to do with the shadow self, not to defeat it, but to embrace it and include it. A crime and punishment scenario, or what I like to call the rewards and punishment story of Christianity, instead of the grace and mercy world that Jesus proclaims. The big and strong win or religion or story, rather than the gospel as tuning in to the real transformation pattern in humanity. Trying to deal with the mystery of evil in some way other than forgiveness and healing. I mean, we really do forget that the way Jesus calls us to deal with evil is through forgiveness and healing, not through warfare and exclusion. So the good news story is the antithesis of the stories of fundamentalism and nihilism or nothingness. So what this is calling for is a story that embraces the soul. That whole notion of yin and yang being held together, that all of us are that way, and that is what love is all about, is being able to hold opposites together and not have to reconcile everything through Western logic. Remember, Christianity, Jesus Christ, and the Bible, none of them is a product of Western civilization or Western logic. The Bible is not a Western document. Jesus is not a Western mind. So recently, I was on a Zoom call with the board that I'm on, and there was a guy there who said, the pandemic seems to me to be a global timeout, where we're all being sent to our rooms to stay there until we learn what we're supposed to learn. Now, Rohr says the education model can be a spectator sport. You can learn a whole bunch of facts, but what is the value that those facts are serving? The transformation story or model risks people knowing and sharing the one spirit that was given us all to drink. We're all supposed to drink from the deep glass of love. So that's what this transformation story is all about, that evil gets transformed, not gets outknown, out-scienced, out-powered, whatever. And it occurred to me that Jesus was talking about sending yourself to your room. Put yourself in time out every day, Jesus would say, and pray in secret. And the divine one of love, who is unseen, will heal and transform you with a new story. And I love finding these photographs of that little boy. He's either put himself into time out or he's been sent to time out. And then this chair, this timeout chair that is designed for somebody to sit on, is time out to think about the things you do, but always remember that I love you. Well, that's a message, I think, from God. So what we're gonna do is spend 5 or 6 minutes in timeout, but not by ourselves, in small groups. And in just a second, Wesley is gonna put us into small groups. And the question is, what was about this was either challenging and you don't like it, or what was calling to you, or what do you think your job is in terms of checking out what story you're living by or you want to live by during this time when we're all isolated or quarantined and in our timeout room?